A very good morning and welcome to the 12th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee. There are no apologies this morning. And our main item of business today is an evidence session on the Fireworks and Pyrotechnics Article Scotland Bill. And I refer members to papers 1 and 2. And I'm very pleased to welcome to today's meeting Fraser Stevenson, Vice Chairman of the British Fireworks Association, Andy Hubble, Chairman of the British Pyrotechnics Association, and Norman Donald, owner of NJE Fireworks Displays, who is joining us remotely on BlueJeans. So a very good morning to you all, and we appreciate the time that you're taking to join us this morning. So we'll now move directly to questions, and if I may, I'd like to open up just with a general question, and I'll maybe come to Fraser yourself first, and then I'll bring in Andy. And it's really just to ask you sort of for a broad comment on your own sort of experience to date from your respective organisations' perspectives of dealing with and supplying fireworks and pyrotechnics articles, as I say, just within the context of your own organisations. So, Fraser, I'll come to you first.
Yes, OK. I've got a kind of prepared statement which will cover the aspects that you've asked for. Thank you, convener, committee members, for the opportunity to speak with you today. As you know, my name's Fraser Stevenson, Vice Chairman of the British Fireworks Association. Now, the British Fireworks Association members import over 90% of the legitimate fireworks placed on the market in the UK. The BFA, which is the abbreviation for the British Fireworks Association, sits on various groups, including the SEN committee, which is a technical committee that covers the European standards and technical standards for fireworks, so we have representation on that. We also have representation on the Firework Enforcement Liaison Group, which is an organisation that includes enforcement authorities, HSE, trade and standards, and also has government representation from the likes of OPSS and BASE. And we also have regular meetings with BASE and OPSS in Westminster. In terms of experience, I've worked in the industry for over 15 years. I've given evidence in Westminster during the 2019 firework inquiry. I was also on the Scottish Firework Working Group, and I've also been an expert witness for various police authorities and prosecutions. And I'm also the lead contact for the UK consumer industry with the European firework industry. So before commenting on the bill, it's worth looking back at the 90s. In the 90s, the number of people admitted to hospital with firework-related injuries was averaging 1,200 a year in the UK. Now, at its peak, it was over 1,500, but it was averaging 1,200 a year in the UK, and deaths were not uncommon. Okay. At the time, fireworks such as bangers, fireworks of erratic flight, display shells, bottle rockets, etc. were available to the public. And I would also add that quite a lot of those fireworks are still available and perfectly legal in Europe, but they were prohibited in the UK because the UK took a step change then. After consultation with the industry, detailed analysis of the types and causes of injuries, the industry proposed a voluntary ban in the UK on the products I've mentioned, which was subsequently enshrined in legislation. The DTI, as it was then, also pushed a massive safety and awareness campaign promoting the safe, considerate and responsible use of fireworks. This was also supported with further legislative change, supported by the industry to close out some areas of concern, such as age limitations, possession, etc. The result today is we have an accident rate that is less than one-tenth of what it was in the 90s. And no deaths in over 20 years. Unfortunately, in 2005, it was decided that the level of support for a coordinated firework safety campaign should be reduced, something the industry feels was not the correct decision. So we're now 17 years from that point, 17 years since a coordinated campaign highlighting the dangers and misuse of fireworks was stopped. However, thankfully, in the past 2 years, working with the industry, OPSS and BASE have restarted a coordinated messaging approach, primarily via social media. The messaging highlights the importance of the safe, considerate and responsible use of fireworks, the importance of reading safety instructions, the importance of buying from licensed authorised resellers, the importance of being considerate to those who may not enjoy fireworks as much. This messaging is working. Why do we say this? In the past 2 years with COVID restrictions, the number of organised events has dramatically reduced to the point of almost zero. The result? Far more consumer fireworks have been sold, with some retailers reporting an increase of as much as 700%. Yet we have not seen a massive spike in accidents, nor have we seen a massive spike in the misuse of fireworks. This would suggest that, in the words of the Minister for Community Safety, there are a number of people, a small number of people, that are using fireworks inappropriately. Why then does the bill appear to target the majority of consumers who are using fireworks in an appropriate way? Also in 2019, the industry recommended that a single point of contact should be created, coordinating safety messaging, market surveillance and intelligence sharing between industry, trade and standards, fire service and police. The recommendations were made to the Firework Working Group in Scotland, the Minister in Scotland and to MPs at the Westminster Inquiry. OPSS have followed this recommendation in England, the Scottish Government have not. Instead, we find that the industry is excluded from much of the activity in Scotland. The BFA were encouraged to speak with Police Scotland about Operation Moonbeam, which we did, and were not asked to be involved any further, at least not until raising this point with the Minister during a meeting in March of this year. We spoke with Scottish Fire and Rescue and even advised them that their safety leaflet was wrong and was encouraging consumers to purchase fireworks which had been made illegal in 2017. Again, we were not asked to be involved further. Finally, we were asked by the Scottish Government to get involved with the SSPCA Fire Safety Campaign in 2021 after we highlighted errors in their 2020 campaign. However, at the first meeting, a member of the SSPCA stated the industry involvement in the safety campaign would make it very difficult for the SSPCA. Convener and committee members, the industry has repeatedly raised concerns regarding the unintended consequences of greater restrictions on the sale and use of consumer fireworks. We've raised these concerns during the working group meeting. We raised these concerns directly with the Minister. Indeed, others have voiced concern, notably the Health and Safety Executive Explosives Inspectorate, who wrote to the Scottish Government in November 2021 stating, "Our view is that, where possible, having two legal regimes containing different limitations for the same thing should be avoided." We have heard numerous references to the need for more tools in the toolbox. The BFA feels that the existing set of tools should be fully utilised before consideration is given to introducing additional legislation. The misuse of fireworks carries a maximum fine in Scotland of £5,000 and 6 months in prison. To the best of our knowledge, the largest fine we can find being handed down in Scotland is £150 to a 19-year-old who admitted using fireworks against two police officers in 2019. What message does that send to those who would misuse fireworks? It certainly doesn't appear to be one of a deterrent. Between 2019 and 2021, the Scottish Government states that there were 53 misuse of firework charges reported to COPFS. How many of those were prosecuted to the full extent of the law? We have asked this question and have yet to receive an answer. The misuse of fireworks includes discharging in a public space or firing into a public space. It also includes using fireworks and pyrotechnics as weapons, supplying age-restricted fireworks and pyrotechnics to anyone under the age of 18, being in possession of an age-restricted firework or pyrotechnic in a public space while under the age of 18. The powers are extensive and have been developed over decades and minimise the risk of unintended consequences. Sadly, the same cannot be said for this bill. And in closing, the 2019 Westminster Inquiry, which heard evidence in public from a wide range of stakeholders, including police, trading standards and the fire service, concluded that greater restrictions and controls on the sale of use of fireworks would not be appropriate due to the real risk of creating a black market and making matters worse, not better. Is it being suggested that things will be different in Scotland? The BFA feels that this bill will be the biggest contributor to the creation of a black market. It does nothing to address the issue of misuse. Instead, it specifically targets law-abiding Scots, placing barriers to purchasing fireworks from authorised retailers and encouraging consumers to look elsewhere. To look to the markets in some European countries where fireworks we banned in the 90s are still perfectly legal. The bill proposes the creation of firework-free zones, when it is already an offence to discharge fireworks in a public space and has been since 1875. The bill will hand over the demand for fireworks in Scotland from licensed retailers to organised crime. It will create more work for enforcement, not less. It will not improve safety. It will result in more injuries, not less. It will lead to deaths. Finally, the industry and the Scottish Government have the same objective: to promote the safe, considerate and responsible use of fireworks to reduce the misuse. The BFA's 10-point plan presented to the Scottish Government in 2020 proposed ways in which this can be achieved whilst minimising the risk of unintended consequences. Sadly, the Scottish Government has chosen a different, more dangerous route. Apologies for the length of time, but I think that kind of covers a lot.
Thank you very much, Fraser. I'll just move straight on to Andy, and then I'll bring in Norman after that. So, Andy.
Thank you very much, Convener. The British Pyrotechnics Association is the trade association that represents the professional firework display industry in the United Kingdom. So if you think of any of the fantastic displays that are held in Scotland, whether it's the really big events or just down to small local community galas or whiskey festivals, the chances are that those have been fired by one of our members. The British Pyrotechnics Association is focuses on skills and competence, has a training scheme that is accredited by City and Guilds, and has various different levels and audit that goes out of our members, and has minimum requirements for a company to become a member, codes of conduct through which companies must operate, disciplinary processes where companies are found to be in breach. We are very much aligned with the firework display industry. So why am I here today? It would be very easy for us to sit back and say that a lot of the proposed bill focuses on focuses on retail, and that actually it's saying go to an organised display, and that's something that's safer. But through all of our experience and all of our knowledge of fireworks, we are very concerned about the black market that will be created by the proposals and what that black market will mean for Scotland and also for the United Kingdom in a larger way. We are really worried about the way that these proposals could take the firework retail market underground, and then the consequences of that are very serious. Now, just to give you a little bit about my background, I've been working in fireworks since the 90s. In the start, I worked on the DTI's fireworks safety campaign. And one of the things that you might have seen is, you know, Lenny Henry holding a sparkler or something like that. I was involved there. And those are the times when fireworks injuries were really high. And I saw the reaction that was taken. And also I saw the reaction that was taken by industry to take steps to remove the fireworks that were the tools of hooligans and antisocial behaviour out of circulation, the industry doing it first to later be backed up by legislation. But the industry did that voluntarily. And I have seen the long working relationship that has carried on over the years, and that occupies a lot of my time at the moment through communications with different departments, but very little from Scotland, unfortunately. A bit about me, I spent 13 years as a special constable. And during that time, I understand what public order is. I understand what antisocial behaviour is. I understand the impact that that can have on society. But I was also there in the 90s and remember what things used to be like. I can remember what the status quo was. And I've helped you a little bit with that by sharing a video that you can have a look at later, just to try and put you back to what things were when fireworks that are now banned were available in the United Kingdom quite legitimately. We support high standards. We support legislation, developing legislation. We've worked on many pieces of legislation, but never before have I felt so passionately that a mistake is being made. And that is why we are here to speak to you speak to the Minister. The committee explained what's been going on and our thoughts on that. But ultimately, we want a safe Scotland and we want safe communities as well. And we're very happy to work with the Scottish Government to achieve that.
Thank you very much indeed. I'll just move straight on to, and I'll bring in Norman Donald. Norman, I hope you can hear us okay. Over to you.
Okay, good morning. My name is Norman Donald. I'm the owner of NJ Fireworks. We're based in Aberdeen. We have a licensed shop that we sell retail fireworks all year round to the public. And we also carry out professional firework display public and all types of events. First of all, I'd like to say I think this bill is completely backward. I agree with Andy and Fraser, and their biggest concern is the black market danger that we're going to put the Scottish public in. Now, we can't be putting the public in danger. If we create a black market, we are definitely going to put the public in danger. Injuries are going to be vast. And as Fraser says, it probably will lead to deaths. As a family business, if this bill goes ahead, as I said, I sell fireworks all year round. I won't be able to close down. If you close my shop down, you're going to take away a specialist shop. Now, a specialist shop, when a member of the public comes in to buy fireworks from us, we are asking questions. Have you bought fireworks before? We are going through the safety instructions with them. We're pointing them in the right directions of what fireworks they can use, which is appropriate for the area. We're reminding them of the laws. We're reminding them to be courteous. Now, if we're not there, and we won't be there to do that. So you're going to take our knowledge away from the public, and that's not good for the public safety either. And if we go down this route and we introduce a licensing scheme as well, that is definitely going to push things under. I've had lengthy conversations with Danny from Diamond Fireworks in Northern Ireland, the licensing scheme, and he'll tell you it doesn't work. All it does is encourages people to buy fireworks elsewhere. Also, if we introduce a fee to get a license, then not everyone can afford a fee. We have some families that come into our shop, they spend maybe £30 on a small selection box, because that's a treat once a year for them, their family, their children. If you introduce a fee, say £30, £50, it could put this out of their reach. So there's no equality there whatsoever. And again, it's going to actually give a class divide. And you're going to punish people on low incomes, which isn't fair. The Minister has suggested that more people would go to professional firework. They might do it if they're within the reach. There's only so many professional firework companies in Scotland, and there's only so many firework displays we can do. So in reality, that isn't going to happen. There isn't going to be more and more professional firework displays. There's only a certain amount of times a year that these happen, November, Christmas lights switch on in Hogmanay. I think we have to maybe relook at this bill from start to finish and look at the things that we're doing wrong, because as I said at the start, this bill is backward. It's not looking forward to Scotland, and Scotland should be looking forward as a nation, not going backwards. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Norman. Your picture at this end is just coming and going a little bit, but we'll hang on in there, and hopefully we'll be able to keep your screen on. We've got quite a number of questions that we would like to ask, that members would like to ask. So I ask for succinct questions and answers, if I may, and I'm going to hand over to Pauline McNeill, and then I'll bring in Rona Mackay. So,
thank you very much. Good morning. Thanks for your evidence. I have to say I found it very, very powerful, but I do have a number of questions, but I'll confine these sets of questions to trying to establish what you think the extent of the problem of antisocial behaviour. Because I think maybe we're all agreed that the problem we're trying to solve is where they are misused. And I suppose I want to draw attention to... So, Andy, in your submission, you talk about the Section 80 of the 1875 Explosive Act, and essentially Pollock Shields, which I have an interest in because I'm a Glasgow member, and I've spoken to the representatives in Pollock Shields, where it is clearly a massive nuisance, not just in November, but in other times of the year. You say in your submission that no action had been taken, and I've been trying to establish this with the Crown Office. I've been unable to yet. So where do you get your evidence from that you're saying that no action was taken? If you could speak to that, that would be really helpful.
Is that directed at Andy or myself?
I think, Andy, it's your submission, the British Fireworks Association. Yeah.
Yeah, we asked the same question about the actions being taken. I was on a telephone, it was a radio call with, I think, Danny from Pollock Shields, and Danny said himself there was no action taken. And as far as we're aware, there was no prosecution taken. Everything that happened there in Pollock Shields, the discharge of fireworks in the public space, handing fireworks out of the back of the van to minors, etc., they were all criminal offences, level 5 fines, £5,000, 6 months in prison. No action was taken.
So is your view that it's not been taken serious enough either by the police or the Crown Office?
It's not been taken seriously. I mean, there's one occasion I was asked to give evidence by... I was interviewed by police officers in Edinburgh who asked me to give them evidence about an attack that had happened upon them. They showed me some product. They asked if that product could cause an injury. So I was there helping the police. And I said, yes, absolutely. And the police officer said, could that have killed us? And I said, yes, if that had hit you, that could have killed you. And he said, good, because we have been told it's not really a good crime and we don't need to prosecute it. And that came from the PF.
Thank you. Just finally, on that point, yeah. I'm trying to get my head around the whole concept of, you know, the legal fireworks and illegal fireworks.
Yeah.
So can you tell, I mean, can you tell the police the difference?
Yes, absolutely.
Forensically, yes. You could tell whether a firework was there. At the end of the day, I suppose it doesn't really matter if it goes off in a public place.
Yes, absolutely. At a working group meeting, there was information or there was a presentation by NHS Scotland, and we highlighted that that what was presented was consistent with an injury sustained from a banger, which has been illegal in over 20 years. That information was discarded. And that information also came from Tom Smith, who's a recognised industry expert. And he concluded the same. The injury that was presented to the working group was consistent with the injury sustained from a banger, which was an illegal product banned over 20 years ago in the UK. And that is what they are getting in the Republic of Ireland. I shared the video with the committee members. I don't know if they saw it. But in the Republic of Ireland, they are 15 years on into a firework ban, a total ban. And they are still doing education in schools, teaching them about the dangers of bangers, which is product that was banned in the UK over 20 years ago. Now, we do not see a lot of bangers on the market. They do appear. I mean, 2 years ago, there was someone in Sheffield selling 4,500 bangers online, and that was reported to the police, and that came through the industry. That was the industry reporting to the police, this is happening. But this is where OPSS have now become involved, and OPSS have set up a direct communication with the industry and said, if you hear anything, contact us directly and immediately. And OPSS is the Office for Product Safety and Standards. And they take that information and they disseminate that information. They'll send that to Trade and Standards, they'll send that to the police, they'll send that to the Fire and Rescue Service. So this is what we try to say during the working group meetings. You need to have a structured, organised reporting method rather than me phoning Govan Police Station and saying, I heard a guy selling fireworks out the back of a van. Well, who are you? Well, I'm Fraser Stevenson from the BFA. Never heard of the BFA. So we need to move away from that. We need to get to a situation where we can communicate to a central point. So fortunately, we don't see those types of products on the market, but they do in the Republic of Ireland.
Thank you. Did you want to add, Andy?
Yeah. It was just to help the committee with what a black market or illegal firework might look like, what we're talking about, because there are lots of different examples. So the one that Fraser's been talking about are the ones that were banned. So those are bangers, air bombs, some screamer rockets, fireworks of erratic flight, aerial shells. A banger, all it does is go bang. We used to be able to buy those 20 years ago for £2 or £3 for a box of 10. And they would cause a real nuisance out in the street. An air bomb, it shoots a projectile up into the sky and all it does is make a bang. Screamer rockets, you know, maybe you can remember 20 years ago. Although, just if it wasn't a bang, it was a whistle. And that was the situation. Aerial shells, they were withdrawn through emergency legislation because two people died from those. Now, those fireworks, all of those, are still available in member nations of the European Union and quite legal. I've sent you a piece of footage about with examples that I filmed largely in Valencia last week, where bangers and air bombs and these kinds of rockets are all legal, and everything you see there is perfectly legitimate. They have a firework festival like we have firework festivals. All perfectly legal, but not allowed in this country. What else might it look like? It might look like fireworks that are labelled in a different language so that you can't understand the safety instructions. It might be fireworks that are not labelled at all, so they don't have any information on them. They might be fireworks that are stored in an unlicensed premises. So at the moment, retailers have a license that they obtain through Trading Standards, and Trading Standards knows where the fireworks are. Yes, they're a white van man, we've heard about that from in Blackburn and so on, but at the moment, Trading Standards have a grip on where all these products are. As soon as you remove that, you take that market underground, we heard that it was a horror of one of the fire officers to be involved in an incident where unexpected fireworks were located. As soon as you take licensing away and people start just storing these products, you will encounter that all along. So it's a whole range of different things that combines the black market. But certainly those fireworks that Fraser talks about that will take your hand off and take your finger off, we don't have them at the moment. You know, not like as easy as it is with a banger if you hold it.
Thank you.
I'll hand straight on to Rona Mackay and then I'll bring in Russell Finlay. Rona.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. You'll be aware that the committee has heard compelling evidence from the Police and Fire Service that, you know, that legislation is required. There was a public consultation last year. 94% of people wanted more control over the sale of fireworks. There was a wide support for a ban. Can I ask you, so far, and reading through your submissions, you're concentrating on misuse and accidents that happen with fireworks. Can I put to you that people have other problems with fireworks, such as, you know, animal distress, people with autism, neurodiverse? Now, that is just a consequence of fireworks going off and the noise that they make. So if you, you know, reading through your submissions, you clearly don't want virtually nothing done, no legislation. So how would you address those problems when the public very much seem to want something done? Because certainly there are, I think someone said that they were going off at New Year and on fireworks night. In my experience, in most people's experience, they're going off a lot more than that. So I wonder if you could come up with any kind of proposal that to show that you understand the frankly nuisance that the public are finding?
It's a difficult question to answer. If I can break it down into different sections. One section, for example, in respect to the noise complaints, we've asked for information about noise complaints, and I've got some statistics here. We asked the City of Edinburgh under a Freedom of Information request for their noise complaint breakdown. And they gave us figures for the period 2013 to 2018. They received a total of 40,385 noise complaints. Of those noise complaints, 44 related to fireworks. The SSPCA, on average, and this is their own information, the SSPCA, on average, receive 123,578 calls a year. Of those, on average, around 20 relate to fireworks.
Can I just intervene there? I mean, I'm a dog owner.
Yeah, and so am I.
I have never complained, although I see the distress it's causing my animals. So not everybody complains when they're, yes. You know, so I understand you're using those figures, but they're not really representative of how the public are experiencing it.
But these are the figures that we've asked for. These are the figures that we've asked to say, OK, how can we address this? How can we help tackle this? How can we help look at mitigation on this? And when we ask the people in power, if you like, for the information to give us to see where we can help, that's the figures we're getting back. So there is concern. We don't like to see the misuse of fireworks. It's not a good thing.
Sorry to interrupt again. It's not necessarily misuse. It's just the use of fireworks. They're not being misused.
Yes,
You know.
Again, it comes back to something that was discussed in the Westminster inquiry. If we try and reduce the overall use of fireworks, the consequences of that are we generate a black market for it. And if we then start going down the black market fireworks, we then lose control of everything. We lose control of licence storage. We lose control of product testing and product safety, etc. And ultimately, we doubt very much it would resolve the problem because as it stands just now, we're working through an organised structure with licensed retailers. There's about 650 licensed retailers in Scotland. So these are retailers who are known to licensing authorities. And these are retailers that we can communicate information to, we can disseminate information to, we can communicate to members of the public about the safe, considerate and responsible use of fireworks, telling your neighbours, etc., etc. But when we speak to people, general members of the public, I want fireworks banned because they're going off at 2 o'clock in the morning and disturbing me. That 2 o'clock in the morning firework is an illegal use of a firework. And restricting the legitimate use of fireworks won't solve that problem. It just simply won't. It's an education thing to the public. It's making the public aware. If you're going to use fireworks, tell your neighbour. It's one of our safety campaign things. It's one of our 10-point... The firework safety code that we promote, which is tell your neighbours. Tell your neighbours if you're going to be doing fireworks so that they can make or take appropriate measures to go somewhere else or you know, go a drive for 10 minutes or something like that. But how to tackle people setting off fireworks in the street or at 2 o'clock in the morning, it's very difficult. It's very difficult.
Okay. Mr Hubble, would you like to comment?
I agree with what Fraser is saying. I think better education is one way that we need to look at and being a better neighbour and sharing that information. He's absolutely right. The alternative is the problem here. The alternative is a lot louder, an awful lot louder, and an awful lot more antisocial behaviour, an awful lot more of a problem. As an association, our members are very aware of noise issues. We promote being a good neighbour, informing all of the properties around, which might be farms or horse owners. And we also very much, our members, work on lower noise displays. It's not possible to have a silent firework. All fireworks will make some noise through their processes. But it is possible to have a fireworks display where, for example, a stables can be located almost next door and the horses actually end up watching the fireworks display. And it is at a certain level, noise level where it doesn't cause them a disturbance. I think most of us in the room will be pet owners or have been pet owners and very much support that. I think anything that educates people and gets people on board with fireworks, but at the same time recognises the huge appeal that they still have. Okay. And also recognises the dangers if we end up with a black market.
I think my colleague's going to have further questions on the noise levels, sure, and silent fireworks, so I won't pursue that. Mr Donald, would you like to comment?
Yeah, I understand. We are a family of pet owners as well. We have a dog. So we understand that dogs can be spooked. All animals can be spooked, like ourselves can be spooked by sudden noises. We do promote the sale of low-noise fireworks in our shop, and we also do a lot of low-noise displays for the public as well. As Andy says, there is not such a thing as a silent firework, but the industry is fully animals and people can be spooked. And as Fraser said, it's all about being courteous. You have to let your neighbours know. It's not a difficult thing to do. And also, dog owners have to take a little. There is ways you can train your dog to desensitise your dog, not just from fireworks, from all sudden loud. We are actually working with a local dog trainer at the moment, and we're actually looking to get 20 dogs in, and we're looking to train them up and desensitise them, and looking to do a firework display for dogs. So we are trying to work together with the community, working together in education, the way forward.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Gabriel.
Thanks very much. We've just taken his audio off just now, sorry, his screen off, just so that we can try and get a better audio feed. So we'll he's still with us, hopefully. I'll hand over to you now, Russell.
Thank you. Hi, Mr. Stevenson. In your opening comments, you made reference to some figures I didn't quite catch. It was to do with the number of cases reported to the Crown Office by the police. Do you have that number to hand?
It's part of the financial memorandum that we took it from.
Yeah.
Let me see if I can get to it. Give me one.
It's quite near the end.
Between 2019 and 2021, it says there was 53 misuse of firework charges reported.
So that was presumably cases reported by Police Scotland to the Crown Office.
Yes.
But we don't know what the...
We've asked the question of the Scottish Government, and we said, what was the result of those 53 reports? How many prosecutions were there? How many convictions? What fines were handed down, etc.?
But anecdotally, the most strong outcome, if you like, was the one that you referenced with the 19-year-old.
That's from what we understand. The person confessed. He was charged, confessed, and sentenced to a £150 fine in his absence.
Okay. Now, one thing that surprised me coming to this fresh was that it's not illegal to give fireworks to under-18s. By those aged over 18, is that the case?
No. There's a bit of a misconception on that. The situation with the proxy aspect of the bill is something that the industry supports because it basically clarifies something that is already illegal. It's an offence within, I think, the Pyrotechnics Directive or one of the firework regulations to supply fireworks to anyone under the age of 18. Age-restricted fireworks to supply. And it is in legislation and has been in legislation for a while, but it's not immediately obvious that it is in legislation, but I can assure you it is. Right. And we've had that discussion with Trading Standards in the past.
So when you say supply, you mean sell or give?
Absolutely, and right. That is the terminology. The legislation is quite specific that right. Supply is to hand over, whether for reward or a prize or anything else or for money, it is to hand over.
I'll have to go back and work out who told us that, but it does seem to be at odds with what some of the authorities seem to think.
Absolutely. Yeah. I can assure you it's in the legislation. When it came up, we spoke to the Scottish Government and we said, OK, it's probably not a bad thing. And you might think, and sorry, convener, but you might think that we're objecting to just everything. And the reason we're not objecting to the proxy is it's already there. So the unintended consequences of that action, we can't foresee any unintended consequences because it's already legislation and it's in the firework regulations.
OK, thank you. Now, you quoted some words the Minister said in your statement as well about this is a small number of people, which goes back to your central point that this should be about enforcement and education rather than legislation. Are you, or do you feel as an industry or industry representatives that you've got an open door, you're being listened to by the government, or is it a bit of an exercise in... consultation, inverted commas?
Speaking frankly, it's isolated voices in a noise of room, in a room full of noise.
Right.
That is pretty much how we feel. I can tell you comments when I've raised concerns about different pieces of legislation, for example, the licensing, and we've said, well, that will just basically encourage people to go and source product from unlicensed or unauthorised. And the comment came back was, law-abiding Scots won't do that. And my response was, well, in fairness, law-abiding Scots aren't really the problem here.
Can you tell me who said that?
It was during one of the working group meetings.
Right, OK.
It was during... And, I mean, I would say that I think it was Jamie Green who mentioned in one of the previous discussions, this is a sledgehammer to crack a nut, but we would go further. It's a sledgehammer to crack the wrong nut.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Sorry. Apologies.
Do you feel you're being listened to?
No. I have sat through... I've been involved in the process for a year and a half or so. Joined working groups when I've been on holiday in other countries, tried to compete... To be involved fully, and I have to say I felt very sorry for Fraser on a number of occasions, and the reason is that the makeup of the working group was a whole load of people who desired change, and regardless of how that came about, change was their goal, and the results that they were referring to in surveys were their mandate to do that. Every time that Fraser contributed, it was correcting a fact that had been put forward in part of the working group. I say every time. That's what it felt like, in that we were, rather than sort of bringing to the table and discussing alternatives and looking at different potential issues or encouraging further engagement with government, as I've seen many times over the last two decades, rather than do that, there were a whole load of people who wanted to achieve change, and everything that was proposed, this man was having to say, well, no, that's not the case, and pulling out a really large amount of facts to contribute to the process. You know, we were already hearing a few of his numbers. Fraser is very good at this. So, yeah, I
hear you. Thank you.
Thanks very much. We're going to move on to some questions around the licensing scheme proposals. Can I ask just for as succinct answers as you can offer? We've got quite a lot of interest and questions to get through. And I'm going to bring in Pauline again, and then I'll bring in Rona Mackay.
Thank you very much, Convener. I think you've responded to a lot of the questions around licences. I'm not going to go over that. I just have one remaining question, which is that... So a significant number of respondents to the Scottish Government consultation were in favour of some kind of licensing scheme. I just wondered if you had any view then, why the general public? And there was quite a significant number of responses to the government. I mean, I guess it could be because they don't feel current law is being enforced, and I think Rona Mackay's point is really important as well, that isn't just the antisocial behaviour element. In most communities, noise after a certain time is a disturbance.
Yeah.
Which clearly out with the law, but this may be what's influencing people. Well, what's your view on that?
Our view on it is, and we've made this recommendation to OPSS. If there was a voluntary way in which, for example, technologies developed to such an extent, we could put a QR code on every firework that's distributed in the UK and consumers could scan that QR code and they could watch instructional videos. They could watch information about what is the current legislation, what is the situation with considerate use, where should you use fireworks, where should you not use fireworks, how should you use that individual firework, but very much make that a voluntary scheme and put that on every single product that people could look at it. But when you take that step into licensing, and You know, we've heard previous evidence from people saying about, oh, the Northern Ireland introduced a licensing scheme. And if you look at the figures that are submitted, Northern Ireland has a population of just under 1.9 million people. On average, they issue 515 licences a year for 1.89 million people. Now, if you prorated that for Scotland, we would be issuing 1,500 licences. We estimate 250,000 people a year buy fireworks in Scotland. Where are the other 248,500 people going to go to buy fireworks? That's our concern. If you took the licence in philosophy and applied it to alcohol and said that before you could buy alcohol, you had to sit an online course to find out about the disruption and the harm that alcohol can cause, etc., etc., and you need to pay £50 to do that, or you can go to the...
Is that what you're really saying when you used the word law-abiding Scots? Are you really saying that the law-abiding Scots might not be so law-abiding if they have to apply for a licence?
Absolutely, it's a risk. If law-abiding Scots are asked to pay £50 and sit an online course, they've basically got three choices then. Choice one is they do it. Choice two is they don't decide to buy fireworks anymore and they stop doing it. Or choice three is some guy approaches them in a pub or out the back of a white van and says, here, I can get you fireworks and you don't need the £50 fee.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Rona, I'll just come...
Yeah, just briefly, just sort of on the licensing and legislation point, Fraser, your submission at the end of, I thought was interesting, the comment you made, further legislation is not required, but of course as an industry we would say that, wouldn't we? I thought that was interesting, because that might be the perception of people who are thinking, well, it is an industry and this is your job.
Yeah.
Would you ever support a scheme where, you know, licences were available for organised displays only and that the public should not be able to buy them individually?
Again, that is effectively a ban.
Well, it's not a ban in firework displays.
Yes, but it's a ban, which is what happens in the Republic of Ireland at the moment. And the consequences of that is horrendous injuries. And it's kids.
Okay, so just to clarify, you don't want anything done? You don't think any changes are necessary at all?
No, we don't say that. What we said is, and we wrote to the Scottish Government on this, and it was one of the points in particular to do with the pyrotechnics aspect of the bill. And we wrote to the Scottish Government and said, look, could you organise a meeting with Police Scotland to discuss with Police Scotland what their primary concerns are and if there is a way in which the industry can help with that? Are there any common suggestions that we could suggest some tweaks to the existing legislation, etc.? We received no response.
Okay.
So, I mean, what we feel is, sorry, really, can I answer your question? We don't think it's appropriate to be looking at more legislation when the existing legislation is not being fully enforced.
Okay.
That's our biggest concern.
Is Mr. Donald still with us?
Mr. Donald, are you able to respond if you want?
Yeah, of course. First of all, you've talked about consultation that they did. Unfortunately, I don't think that the figures of that should be looked at all, as in what the Scottish public think, because this consultation was, and I know for a fact that a lot of this consultation, especially with an anti-firework brigade in England, they shared this on their Facebook page. They've over 20,000 followers. And published their members to answer the consultation in Scotland because they were hoping for a change and that would maybe progress to a change in England. So the consultation.
Sorry, Mr. Donald, can I interrupt you? What evidence have you got for saying that?
The evidence I asked when I was on about this, I asked the question, was this out with Scotland? And the answer was yes. I asked if anyone in the world could answer this, and they said, but this doesn't represent Scotland. And the answer was was that the civil servant said that this is the way that the SNP carry out consultations all the time. I was unaware. The Minister was actually in Parliament and she was reading out the figure. She said that 10% of the Scottish public are looking for a fundamental change in the way fireworks are sold in Scotland. And it's true, because the figures have come from worldwide. If you look on the Anti-Fireworks Brigade's Facebook fab, you'll see that they shared this, and they've also shared the one that yourselves asked for just last month for the members to answer this. So the figures that we're getting completely, so we can't rely on what the consultation, you know?
So you don't believe in consulting the public?
Of course I believe in consulting the public, but the Scottish public, not England, Wales, Ireland, the rest of the world, should be looking after Scotland. It's why should people in England decide on what legislation should be in Scotland?
Well, I think you're giving your opinion there, Mr Donald. I don't think that's correct, but we'll leave it at that. Thanks.
OK, thank you. I'll bring in Russell Finlay now.
Yes, thank you. In respect of licensing, potentially creating a black market or a bigger black market, and using Northern Ireland as an example of what can potentially happen, do you have anything, any insight from either colleagues or perhaps even Trading Standards in Northern Ireland about the size and the extent of the black market that's been created?
Yeah, it's a really difficult question to answer, because how do you know the size of something that's illegal? How is it recorded? How is it detailed? I mean, what I can say is that it's one of the concerns in the Republic of Ireland is they feel their black market is coming a lot from Northern Ireland. So there you've got geographically two countries joined together, both with completely different legal regimes on the sale and use of fireworks, and you've got this transfer of product from one area to the other area. And that kind of falls in line with the comment I made from HSE, which is where you know they would caution against having two different legal regimes for the same product in the same area. So you can read it that England becomes the equivalent of Northern Ireland and Scotland becomes the equivalent of the Republic of Ireland, and we have cross-border. And I know that was a question that was raised to one of the police officer. And, you know, it's one of the questions we've asked. What is the plan here? Is the plan to stop drivers coming across the M74 and the A1 and saying, show me inside your car so I can see if you've got illegal fireworks? But, yeah, I do have to say in the UK, certainly it's a small percentage of the black market, but Republic of Ireland, it's huge, and it is bigger, certainly bigger in Northern Ireland, and we know this from colleagues in Northern Ireland.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. Any other, you want to come in on licensing? Okay, thanks very much. Well, in that case, we'll move on to some questions around the sort of restrictions on use and supply of fireworks, and I'll bring in Colette Stevenson to begin with, and then I'll bring in Fulton McGregor.
Thanks, convener, and good morning to the panel. Obviously, in regards to the restrictions, the bill introduces various restrictions on the days and times when fireworks can actually be sold and used. And it was really just to seek your views on that proposal in terms of the actual restrictions. And, you know, do you think it strikes the right balance in terms of people actually being able to enjoy fireworks at appropriate time in various different celebrations, and arguably reducing the actual misuse of fireworks as well.
Right. I don't know if Andy's got I'm going for this one. Again, it comes back to this thing where greater restrictions and controls, the risk presented from that through things like consumer stockpiling. And I know that's a concern that was raised, I think, from the Scottish Police Superintendents. in their response to the committee. They stated that they had concerns over stockpiling. I also believe that COSLA mentioned concerns over stockpiling in their submission. Fife Council mentioned concerns over stockpiling in their submission. And the Scottish Community Safety Network also mentioned concerns about stockpiling in their submission. And that this is the problem. If you start restricting, then people will say, well, I've got a birthday in May, so what I'll do is I'll buy those fireworks in November or December, and then I'll keep them in the house until May. So you've got a question about the sourcing of the product, and there will be people that decide to stockpile, or there may well be people who decide to stockpile for reselling.
Can I come in on that?
Yeah.
See, in terms of the actual production now, I don't know how to actually make a firework or what's involved in it.
Okay.
But is there any way that it could be, there could be a time, a date on that? And the limit in terms, is there nothing that you could do?
No, that's it. To explain the overall process of fireworks, about 95% of the world's consumer fireworks are made in China. And firework production has got a 9-month lead time. So you're ordering in January for stuff that you're expecting in August or September. But even putting, there is certain things that we have to put dates on from a point of view of a production date, but that's more to do with the Pyrotechnics Directive. Being able to identify whether a product was sold in November or December, or, I mean, it would be incredibly difficult to track and trace something like that once it gets into the consumer market.
Okay.
I don't know if that answers your question. No.
No, I'm just wondering what options are there in terms of the restrictions and not stockpiling them.
Yeah.
I don't know, Andy, if you want to come in on that in terms of that balance there.
Yeah, absolutely. You were saying about what is the impact and what are the restrictions on restricting the days that fireworks happen. Clearly, it impacts on people's freedoms, and it means that you are telling them you can only celebrate with fireworks on these days of the year. So if you have a wedding or you have a birthday party or your company has a special celebration or a gala prom for a school or whatever, then you are limiting and saying that no longer can you do those unless you use a professional fireworks display company. And this has been one thing that's in my submission in quite clearly that does disadvantage low-income households, because low-income households are not likely to be able to afford the services that our members can provide, which is an organised professional fireworks display, whereas if they were to go to a fireworks shop in Scotland and buy a small selection of fireworks to celebrate a wedding, then that would be affordable. So those are the consequences of restricting when you can do it. I think that you are creating an unbalanced status quo.
Okay, thank you. And I suppose if I put it to, sorry, is it Norman? Is he still online with us? Yeah. Uh-huh. And really, Norman, if you could even give me some indication if there would be an impact on retailers in terms of the restrictions as well.
Norman, are you able to respond to that? I don't know if you heard that question, if you'd like it repeated again.
It looks like he's lost from the list, so I'll have to try and bring
him back. Okay, right, it looks like we've lost him, so want to move on?
Yeah, well, I don't know if Fraser or Andy can comment in terms of the retail aspect of it, and if they have got any evidence that would suggest that restricting them would have a huge impact and lead to, you know, more sales online and through the black market as well.
I believe as part of the evidence, I think as part of the consultation of the bill, there was identified that there was about 12 all-year licensed retailers in Scotland. And obviously that would just kill them dead. But it wouldn't solve the problem. This is what we keep coming back to. So rather than Scots being able to go to a local licensed retailer, what would they do? They'd go online and buy them from somebody in England, or they would go online and buy them from somebody in Poland or Holland or Germany or Czech Republic or whatever, and get them sent over. And the implications of that are far greater. And it does happen. It does happen. People, you can, I could go online today, take you to a website, buy a legal product, and it'll be here within a week. I could do it.
And if you get any idea of the actual, the amount that, you know, I know Russell asked that question as well, but I'd be really keen to know, well, in terms of even trading standards, just right, how big it is in terms of the black market.
If I give you a real world example, and this happened 2 years ago, somebody we know was asked to go to Coventry Airport Sorting Office to collect fireworks, which had been discovered by HMRC and had come in on an aircraft from Poland, a commercial aircraft from Poland, and they opened the box and they found 23 kilograms of bangers in the box. And the box was destined for the Republic of Ireland. So the ultimate delivery address for that 23 kilograms of 1.1G, what we call 1.1G explosives, which is the highest rating on explosives. Fireworks are down at 1.4 in general. Some are 1.3, but 1.1 is the highest. So that was 23 kilograms of bangers. Now, what was it that took down the Lockerbie plane? I mean, it was a fraction of that, an absolute fraction of the amount of power.
Andy, do you want to come in?
Yeah, I've been involved in the last year in bangers that have been brought into this country, brought into the UK, which are of a type which is very concerning. They are not only there are bangers where that you would light. This is a banger with an impact sensitive initiator on them. So we've all seen those little tadpole like things that you can throw on the ground and they go bang. This is a great big banger that's got impact-sensitive composition that's found itself into the UK for sale online and just literally throw it on the ground. Those are the kinds of online things that we're going to see, but it will just spiral. This bill would be a disaster for Scotland, and forgive me for keep saying this, it would be a disaster. You would almost immediately see the creation of a big black market, which has been seen in other countries. This has been the message that the industry has brought to governments for many, many years, since the 90s. You know, the British industry was working with COSLA on the regulations that resulted in the 2003 Act. And, you know, when we sit here and we talk about enforcers who say that they don't have the tools to deal with things, those enforcers, they helped make those regulations beforehand to give them the powers to deal with antisocial behaviour. And for 20 years, we've dealt with antisocial behaviour quite successfully. So to then sort of say that we need further legislation to deal with it, when actually it's not being dealt with, I apologise for going off at a tangent. But yes, it will create black markets, white vans, everything, websites.
OK. Thanks very much.
Yeah, thanks very much. I'm going to bring in Fulton McGregor, and then I'll bring in Jamie Green.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, panel. I've got one question that's on the back of Colette's line of questioning, and it's around about the times, you know, that the bill is proposing. So we've had some questions around this, and it's an area that I've been asking various panellists on. We've got some concerns about it. I think the previous panellists that have spoken to us have, generally speaking, been in favour of it, and that's been reassuring for me as a committee member. I'm guessing you might have a different view, but I would like to give you the opportunity to give your view, if it is different, to explain that. One of the concerns we've got is by picking dates by the government or the parliament, because ultimately it will be the parliament, by selecting dates, you're therefore, you know, ruling out other dates that may be important to people. Do you envisage that being a difficulty for the bill going forward? You know that there's certain days that fireworks can be used and other days they can't. From both perspectives of the days that they can't be used, they might be important festivals or milestones mm-hmm. for individuals, but also a point that Pauline McNeill has raised a couple of times, that also people may choose to then have fireworks on days that are not necessarily a festival for them,
yeah.
If that makes sense.
Yeah.
I wonder if you can hear your views on that.
Again, it's a situation of distinguishing between the misuse of fireworks out with those periods and the intentional misuse, if you like. So if you have if you introduce these restrictions on these certain days, you may reduce the misuse, or you may reduce the use of fireworks by law-abiding citizens. But how do you address the people who will deliberately and intentionally go out and use fireworks because they're being told not to use fireworks? It just creates this spiral. And we've seen it. We've seen it in so many places where let's do this because we think this will solve the problem, and it makes it worse. OK, so we've not done enough, so we need to do this, and it makes it worse. OK, so let's keep going and keep going until we ultimately say you cannot use fireworks ever, anywhere, at all, and you still have the problem. And that is our concern, is the periods of use thing will have unintended consequences. It will have unintended consequences. I mean, there was evidence given by Scottish Fire and Rescue who felt that if there was restricted periods of use, there would not be fireworks in shops out with those periods of use. That's not the way the firework licence works. The firework storage licence is an annual licence. So that retailer has to store those fireworks in appropriate conditions all year round. So if you turn around and say you can't use fireworks between date A and date B, there's not a magic wand that's going to go around Scotland removing every firework from every retailer. It just won't happen. It's not the way the system has been developed over 20, 30 years. Well, in fact, over 150 years, if you look back at the 1875 Act.
So I'm pretty clear on what your view on the overall bill is. You made that pretty clear in your statements at the start. Yeah. But, you know, if you're assuming that legislation in Parliament is going to pass legislation, you'll want to be involved in certain aspects of that as well. So on this particular issue, this particular part of it, so not overall bill just now, this particular part of it, what do you think about these proposals? Should we just not have any dates? And obviously the complications that would bring, because New Year and stuff like that would obviously be days when maybe what you're suggesting would happen could happen. Or do you think there should be flexibility for local authorities to meet individual needs and requirements? Because that's another thing that we've heard a bit about. I see you, Andy, maybe.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you very much. I think there is a... Yes, there may be problems with specifying dates, but I think that you cannot draw a comparison necessarily with existing regulations that do specify certain dates, such as Diwali, and New Year's Eve and so on like that, because some of those specifically are to do with late night use of fireworks because of when the festival takes place, and they give extensions beyond the 11 p.m. regulation that you can use fireworks. What we're saying is that should there be other dates of the year that should be specified on the legislation? Well, quite possibly there are community groups that would say yes, absolutely. And there will be festivals and there will be events, like we have the Jubilee coming up this year, and there will no doubt be many more. And the need, whether that is down to local authorities, my only concern with local authorities, from my experience, is that local authorities can be very... unbalanced in their application from one authority to another. It is very important to apply things for your particular area, but I can't... Where one authority might approve something, another authority may say no for a completely different set, depending on who the members are and their feelings on something. So I would have thought that it would have been become a central matter, rather than sending it out to the local authorities. But yeah, I'm sure there are other dates that ought to go on there. And if you were going to go down the route specifying dates, which I really, I don't think we should have those restrictions, but if you were, then I think that you would absolutely need to have some way of adding dates in.
And I guess so, in terms of the point there about local authorities, that's the beauty of them being democratically elected. I don't have a lot of difficulty with that, if there's different decisions made between local authorities, because, you know, they can obviously make decisions based on manifestos that they stand on as well, and what the public in their particular areas want around these issues. And that brings me on to my final question, convener, as well, if that's all right, which is more of a general one. Thank you for the answers on that area. But, I mean, you've both put forward, a really good case today. You've articulated it really well. But I think, it won't be any surprise to you that, it's the opposite from what we've kind of heard up to now. And I think you've reflected that, Fraser, as well. And, when I'm listening to your case, I'm thinking there's certainly some good points here. I then think back to the 6th and 7th and 8th of November and various other days since being an MSP, where my inbox is flooded with people wondering what the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Government are going to do about fireworks. And it is pet owners, people with autistic children. You know, the world's moved on since even, we were talking about earlier when we were all younger than that. I grew up in the 80s and we love fireworks, but the world's moved on from them. We understand people's needs better now. We have more of a community spirit around people who maybe don't like fireworks. Before, in the past, it was the case of, well, if you've got an autistic child, tough. Now, that's not the case anymore, and quite rightly so. So I think that, that's where the government and the parliament are coming from. And I suppose my question is, because I'm rambling on a bit, my question is, do you have any sympathy with the part of the legislation here might not be to solve fireworks issue overnight? It might create some of the issues that you've said, but actually some of it is about changing our relationship with fireworks. It's about changing the culture in Scotland with fireworks, and about making that slow progress and the powerful message it can be given by a government and a parliament passing legislation for that, and saying to these people who contact us, saying, this might not be perfect legislation, but you know what, we're hearing what you're saying and we're going to try and do something about it. I'll put that to you.
We do sympathise 100%. We want the safe, considerate and responsible use of fireworks, absolutely. But we feel that a headline in a media newspaper saying that somebody was fined £5,000 for misusing fireworks in a specific area would send a really powerful message to those who would consider doing the same. And I would also add as well that in the last 2 years, we have seen a dramatic increase in the amount of consumer fireworks being sold and used. But we've not seen a massive spike in the issues of attacks, etc. And that was the information given by Police Scotland and Scottish Fire and Rescue. So I don't understand why people think that by reducing or trying to reduce the amount of legitimate use of fireworks, they think that will have an impact on the misuse and the annoyance and the noise, etc. Because if more people are using fireworks, but those core numbers haven't really changed, why do we think that squeezing the legitimate use of fireworks will reduce those complaints? There is a hardcore element. I believe it was David Hamilton who said, because if bad people are going to behave badly, they will do so wherever they are. And that is what our concern is. There is an aspect of misuse, antisocial behaviour, ill consideration for consumers and members of the public. And all this bill is doing is going after the law-abiding Scottish citizen, and it won't impact that misuse. So you will still have people complaining. You will still have people sending emails to you. You will still have issues with attacks on emergency services, etc. And we've seen that in other countries around the world. And it will just escalate. And then you'll want more regulation and more regulation and more regulation until you've regulated it, till everything's illegal. And you will still have the problems. But it will just be so much worse. That's our concern.
And I do. I think you've made that point, and it is something that I think the committee have heard throughout the evidence sessions. But I suppose the point I was asking there, and I'll ask it to yourself, Andy, was about the message that's sent. And yes, we might well be on a journey, Fraser. That's something that I think the committee's, got in the back of their mind as well. This might be a journey rather than, the end, to somewhere that the public find more acceptable with fireworks. And that's what I was saying about, you know, the Parliament and the government sending a message, you know, and maybe being clear that, you know, it might not solve all issues. Have you got any views on that, Andy?
Yeah, you made a very good point as well. From your perspective, I don't underestimate the popularity of fireworks, is what I would say. I was fortunate to not be working on Hogmanay, and I was able to watch a live feed of fireworks. Now, the thing with Hogmanay is it's very unique in that at midnight, whether it's here or it's in England for New Year's Eve or whatever, everybody lets the fireworks off at the same time. Whereas for Guy Fawkes, they're on a number of different nights and they're at a number of different starting times. And this camera feed, which panned across and showed fireworks going off everywhere because people enjoy them and people appreciate the enjoyment they bring to families, it just strikes me that by introducing licensing and by limiting the days, that you drive the industry, you drive retail out of Scotland, because I'm sure the supermarkets won't continue because they won't have the volumes to be able to do with their 5 kilogram limit on the amount that they can sell. Then there's the specialist retailers who are limited to 37 days and can no longer do this. So for all of these options that it used to be to sell fireworks, we've already seen some supermarkets go. And I just see that as a member of the public, not as a part of the retail trade. With all of this gone, this popularity of fireworks, where are they going to get them from? They're going to get them from the white van man in Blackburn, or they're going to get them across the border. And you have a difficult job, and you must strike the balance, but don't underestimate how popular they still are and how some of these controls and restrictions will affect families. You know, families that might just want to spend £5 on a small box of fireworks to light up the face of their youngsters in the back garden. And now they have to spend get a big licence.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks very much. I'll bring in straight to Jimmy Green.
Thank you, and good morning. I mean, I hear what you're saying, that they'll still be popular, and, you know, smoking was popular, but we introduced restrictions around that. It's now antisocial. Driving without a seatbelt was the norm, but we don't do that anymore. You know, smoking opium in the 1800s was popular, but we don't do that either. So, you know, do you not think we are just on a bit of a journey, and we may just have to accept that at some point in the future, you know, there will be a blanket ban other than technology moving on with digital light displays and drones and other forms of new technology that can do forms of pyrotechnic which don't affect animals and people with sensitivities.
I understand where you're coming from. I'm not sure that we are on a journey with all of the people that still love fireworks and still enjoy the fireworks. When we look at other countries, there were three nations that introduced temporary bans for New Year's Eve on the sale of fireworks, and that was COVID related. It was just to stop gatherings. And those three countries reported high numbers of accidents and also fatalities. I believe one of the fatalities was from people that actually made their own fireworks. It just goes to show you that in those countries where there were bans and it was against the law to have them, and this is only a few months ago, people still went out and bought them. Mm. We look at, Hawaii. Hawaii is incredible. Thousands of miles from land and fireworks completely banned. There's so many photographs of the fireworks going off in Hawaii on July the 4th online, and it's just absolutely bonkers. The whole point that we're saying is I have absolutely no doubt that the industry would be very happy and willing and has always been to engage with government and go down that journey together and to find some common areas and to work on them, like has been done in the past. But once you go down the route of creating a black market, there's no going back. And once you get the fatalities in Scotland that result from some of these very powerful fireworks, you know, it's difficult to know what I would say to the Scottish Government after that.
And I'll come to you in a second, Fraser, because I've got some other questions. I mean, one end of the spectrum, the government could have introduced just a complete ban, and if that's the government's of the day's policy, then so be it. And I suspect the government would have the numbers in Parliament to achieve its ambition. And at the other end of the spectrum, we do nothing. And we hear about this perceived rise in antisocial behaviour and a perceived rise in attacks on blue light services. Now, I think there's still some ambiguity around the data. I mean, I personally would like to see a little bit more accuracy in what those numbers are. I think we all would, for the sake of transparency. But, you know, there's an extreme options to is what I think what it's been suggested to is that this bill is somewhere in the middle. It's not a ban. It still allows members of the public at certain times of the year to go and purchase use fireworks and allow organised events to take place during the whole year appropriately. So don't you think it is actually striking a balance? And I'm saying this as a devil's advocate because I'm slightly nervous about the legislation, but I'm trying to probe you on whether this is maybe the balance that we're looking for. I'll come to you first, Fraser, actually.
For us, it's a risk-reward scenario, and that's the best way of describing it. I mean, we've heard people say, oh, it might create a black market, oh, it's one of the tools, we need to do multiple things, etc. And we're sitting saying, look at other examples around the world where, with the best intentions, people have tried to do things, and it has simply made them worse. And that's the message we keep repeating. It has simply made them worse. We currently are in a situation where we basically have no deterrent to the misuse of fireworks. There is no deterrent to the misuse of fireworks. £150 fine for two police officers. That's £75 a police officer. I mean, where is the deterrent? Why are we not seeing headlines saying £5,000 fine? This person was fined £5,000. And again, that is where the frustration is. I've been to several of the public engagement meetings way back, and I spoke to members of the public, and they said, oh, we see kids in the street setting off fireworks. And I said to them, well, that's a criminal offence. Why is there nothing being done about it? Well, I don't know. You're asking the wrong person, asking me. And it's all of these scenarios. So one question was asked about the surveys and asking members of the public. Some of the questions that have been asked, I would have said yes. If somebody turned around and said to me, do you think something has to be done? I'd say yes. Mm-hmm. And the qualification was greater enforcement of the existing legislation and better education of the public. Mm-hmm. And that's the difficult situation we're in. Come back to what I think it was yourself said. Republic Ireland has been on a 15-year journey and it's not getting better.
I'd like to maybe, and I think as a committee we should try and explore that, because you've referenced the Republic of Ireland, which seems to have gone much further than our proposed legislation, and I don't really feel we've taken the evidence other than anecdotal. So, you know, we should be evidence-driven on that. But you're right, the police have told us directly, they say this will be another tool in their toolbox. Mm. Are you saying, therefore, that it's actually a lack of use of existing legislation or... and misunderstanding of current legislation, that they already have the tools that they need and therefore it's just a perception that this will give them more
tools? That's one of the questions we've asked the Scottish Government. Organise a meeting with the police. Organise a meeting with the police in the industry. Sit around the table and say, OK, guys, where do you think there's gaps in this? What is that? Is there something that we can do? And don't be looking at something that's... Scotland's problems would not be Scotland's problems in isolation. There will be stuff that will come across the border, whether that's across the border from Poland or Czech Republic or England or whatever. But we have repeatedly asked for engagement with the police to say, understand what is happening. Mm-hmm. I mean, again, if I give you examples, the situation we have with OPSS, the product that Andy mentioned, the banger that works, okay. We reported that through OPSS. OPSS asked us for the technical evidence to say why that product was illegal, what the risk was presented with it, etc. OPSS then went and disseminated that information to Trading Standards, the police, and there was arrests, and as we understand it, prosecutions are underway. But that's how the system should be working, as the industry being able to engage with enforcement authorities, etc., and work out how to make the current legislation more effective, how to get the results that everybody wants. I don't want your dog getting upset by fireworks. In the same way as, I don't, well, Our last dog just passed away 2 weeks ago. But we didn't want our pets getting upset with fireworks. Nobody wants that. But the risk presented by trying to fix that is to make things so much worse. Mm-hmm. And that's our point.
Andy, can I ask you about the retail side of things? Because, you know, the devil's in the detail with this bill. There are currently around 650 retailers who sell fireworks, of which we think there are around a dozen dedicated. Now, the expectation is they'll just go under overnight, really. I mean, you can't really operate 30 days a year as a business when you have a shop front and rent to pay, even if they're compensated to some extent. But, you know, we all know what government compensation schemes look and feel like. So let's assume they go. That then, where do people then go? You're talking about supermarkets, that leaves around 630-odd. Are they going to stop selling them? Or do you think they'll still stock them if they can only sell them at certain times of the year? I mean, this idea that we can dip in and out of when you can buy and use and sell them with the restrictions of the sale, use and purchase, that those three strands that are available to government, do you think perhaps we should just focus on one or two of those elements? And because there is going to be legislation, whether we like it or not, it's just the case of what does that final legislation look like? Do you think there's maybe a better way we could shape the bill going forward that still allows the public the freedoms that they deserve whilst tackling the problem?
I think, Jamie, with the greatest respect, that probably is better answered by Fraser in terms of the impact that it's going to have on those retailers.
Yes, please.
It would be unfeasible. The practicality of having to verify, check, queues of people lining up in Tesco trying to buy their family fireworks and being asked to produce evidence that they've sat an online course and paid a £50 fee, etc., etc. I personally don't think they would tolerate it. I think they would just say, you know what, this is more hassle than it's worth. We'll just stop selling them and crack on. Leave yourselves to it.
Yeah, I mean, we haven't taken evidence from supermarkets specifically. It might be worth writing to them. But, I mean, there is a difference between buying something in a supermarket or a big multi-chain type environment. Yeah. I won't name names. And I'm going to your small local family-owned fireworks shop, where you have a very direct one-to-one relationship.
Yeah. Yeah.
Do you think there's a benefit to having that type of retail relationship with the consumer versus, you know, the big supermarket environment where really it's just a cashier just doing an age check, for example, and pretty much nothing more? There's not that conversation element to it.
They don't have the conversation element, but they certainly have the checks and balances from a legal fulfillment point of view. But this comes back to what I said earlier, a QR code, you know, a simple QR code on every firework. The public would just get their mobile phones, scan the QR code, and it would tell them how to use that firework appropriately, the legislation, etc., 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 all of the checks and balances that you're speaking about from a licensing point of view, but without the financial barrier or the discouragement and basically forcing people to look elsewhere. And that's what we've promoted, that's what we've suggested to both the Scottish Government and Westminster, is to have some kind of joint education, training, awareness to minimise the unintended misuse of fireworks. And that's the best way of describing it. There's the intended misuse of fireworks, which is premeditated, and all the legislation in the world will never stop that. Mm-hmm. And there is the unintended misuse of fireworks. People who don't know about the legislation, they don't know what the current law is, they don't know what times are supposed to be setting off fireworks, not after 11 p.m, etc., etc. So these are measures that we're suggesting that don't require the sledgehammer and the potential implications of swinging that sledgehammer.
And just finally, I appreciate that we're running out of time, but you know, you're talking about use of technology to improve safety. I mean, rather than a full-blown licensing scheme, which, for all the reasons that it may create a sort of class division amongst usage, and indeed those can afford to get fancy companies into their big back gardens will do so, and they'll do it anyway, any time of the year, but those who can't afford to do that will be unable to. So your next-door neighbour has a fire display, and you don't, because you can't afford to employ a private company to do it. I mean, that's a ridiculous situation. Yeah. But is it not better, for example, if I do go into the supermarket, we're all used to flashing QR codes now, that I need to have perhaps done an online safety course of a couple of minutes or a few slides, and that produces a code which is personal to me, and I show that to the cashier, and that allows me to make the purchase. I mean, is that maybe a better application of technology?
It's a potential thing, but we always feel that the best way to impart information is at the point of use or the point of supply.
Okay.
And this is where having something on the specific product is a thing. I'll also highlight, while we're speaking about the licensing thing, and I'll try and keep it brief, there is an unintended consequence which we brought up as part of the working group. So if you're no longer prevented from using fireworks at your home address, for example, now whether that's because of a firework free zone or whether that's because of the dates of use, etc., inadvertently, what you're effectively saying to the public is, well, go out in the street and put the firework down and light it. Then it's not in your garden. You've got nothing to do with it. And stand back and say, I don't know who lit that firework. It was going and I came out and looked at it. And I know some people might think that's far-fetched, but stuff like that will happen because, well, how do they trade? How do they know it's me that lit that firework? If I set it off in the park and stand outside the other side of the fence, does anybody know it was me that set that firework off? Nobody does. So again, it's this situation about trying to introduce things to solve problems, but not actually looking at the full picture and saying, what is the knock-on effect of doing that? What is going to happen with stockpiling? What's going to happen with black market? What's going to happen with the white van man? You know, I mean, there's comments being made that this bill's a white van man charter. Because they literally will be sitting rubbing their hands at this. They will be sitting rubbing their hands. So not only are they going to be able to supply fireworks to people who have not sat a licence, they're going to be given the opportunity to supply them during periods where fireworks are not permitted for supply. You know, it's just an absolute field day for these kind of guys. And that's what we don't want. That's what we don't want.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Yes. Okay, thanks very much. I'm just going to pick up on a couple of points that were raised in Jamie's questioning, just around your early questions about this situation around a complete ban, which is something that we've asked other witnesses about, and they've shared their thoughts on that. And it was really just to clarify that any sort of proposal around a ban wouldn't be within the gift of the Scottish Parliament or the Scottish Government to put that in place. That would be a UK Parliament decision. And also, again, linked to that in terms of the option around a QR code, again, that's something that wouldn't be in our gift. That would be something that the UK Parliament would need to take forward. So just to sort of give a bit of clarification around that. Just on the questions that Jamie was asking, particularly around the impact of the restrictions on business, I'm going to bring in Norman, because I think we do have him back again. But before I do that, I'd just like to pick up on another point that Jamie made, and it was around the sort of legislative provision for Police Scotland, and I think earlier on you've really indicated that there might be scope for the existing legislation to maybe be better used more effectively by police officers. And you'll be aware that the bill proposes a new offence or set of offences around sort of travel to and from certain events, certain public assembly, that type of thing. So I'm interested to ask if you feel that, given your comments about perhaps better use of existing legislation, if you feel that the proposal around the new offence would actually be another welcome tool in the toolbox, as it were, for Police Scotland in terms of controlling sort of illegal use of fireworks, albeit in a sort of specific context around sort of sporting events in the main. Just I'll come to you, Andy.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, absolutely. I used to be a police officer. I understand the challenges that our law enforcers face.
I understand all of that.
I do apologise. I understand that. And of course, if that is a particular problem, then I would support it. But I would say that I believe that existing legislation is already there. And I can see some gaps, but I think that those gaps are gaps that could be closed perhaps another way. For example,
We already had Section 1 of the Police and Criminal Evidence Act with the powers for search, and they've specified fireworks. But one of the problems that we've got is a very technical issue, and that is that some of these devices that are turning up at sporting events, by legal definition, are not a firework. They're a pyrotechnic article, mm-hmm. which is where the bill comes in. But, you know, perhaps we could change the Police and Criminal Evidence Act, and actually that would be beneficial for not just Scotland. It would be a universal thing. And also, it's the same, really, with Section 80 of the Explosives Act, 1875. Now, that's the power that you may not fire a firework in a public place or on a road or so on. That was actually amended by a Scotland Act to change some of the wording in that. And that probably only needs another slight change to incorporate the pyrotechnic article. And by making those changes, you achieve the same thing.
Yep. Okay, thanks very much. I'll bring in Norman. Norman, I don't know if you're still with us. I hope you are. Maybe just if you would like to respond to some of the questions from Jamie Green about the impact of restricted dates in particular. I think it was either yourself, Jamie, or Fulton spoke about restricted dates and whether that might impact on your business.
Yes, it's definitely 100% going to impact on my business. Unfortunately, I will have to close my shop down and I will cease to exist as a retail firework company. It's simple as that. I can't be paying rent, internet rates, things to only sell at specific dates. It's economically, it's not viable for me to do that.
Okay, thanks very much. Colette, are you want to come in on that and then I'll bring in Russell?
Yeah, it was really more to do it was Rona Mackay that sort of touched upon it. And it's something I have been seeking the views from all the working group and the people that have came along. But it's to do with silent fireworks. You've said that there's no such thing as silent fireworks, but there's low-noise fireworks. And I guess for me, and even when I shared the actual consultation on my own Facebook page, that is what most a lot of folk came back and said to me was, could we not just have silent or low-noise fireworks then? And I suppose when Norman's talking about the impact that would have on restricted days, if we were to exclude that, but bring in low noise fireworks, would that not be the answer to a lot of the concerns that folk are raising, particularly to do with noise, the impact it has in the dogs, the animals, and the sensory issues it has with people with autism as well?
My red light's on. Low noise fireworks are available at the moment to consumers. It's a matter of choice. They're widely available. It's not a new development. It's not a new thing. They've been available for several years. But this comes back to the education considerate use of fireworks. Now, maybe the general public or some sections of the general public don't know they're available. But I can assure you, Norman will retail low-noise fireworks. I know other people that retail low-noise fireworks for consumers. So it's not a new development. They are available. But if you start to then go back to this situation where you prescribe that people can only use that, then that makes another element of the general population say, well, OK, well, where can I buy fireworks that aren't low-noise? And then you expose them to that whole gamut of online sales, whether that's from England or whether that's from Poland or the Czech Republic. And then you end up in this situation where you don't have fireworks that are limited to 120 decibels. You're getting fireworks that are 125 or 130 decibels. So in trying to solve one problem, you can inadvertently generate another problem, which is far worse than the one you're trying to solve. So education to the public and saying, we would encourage you out with the normal seasonal periods to go and buy low noise fireworks. They're readily available. They are available.
Thanks very much. Norman, can I just ask you about the sale of low noise fireworks and what is the cost comparison compared to high noise fireworks?
They're roughly about the same. But as Fraser said, it's educating people that there is low noise. People don't know that they exist. You do offer that when they come into the shop, and we let people know that there is low noise fireworks for them to buy. But the price is roughly about the same.
Okay, and in terms of selling them, has it become more popular, the demand for low noise? How does that sit in terms of your stock?
To be honest with you, it's slowly starting to improve, as in more people are asking for it, because more people are being more considerate as we educate them more. So I think over the years to come, it will get more popular. But unfortunately, not unfortunately, that's maybe not the right word, people do like loud noises, and they love that bang and the woo, and that's part of the excitement of the fireworks. So we can't make them buy low-noise fireworks. That's entirely their choice.
OK, thanks very much. No further questions.
OK, thanks. I've got Fulton coming in with a very brief question, and then I'll bring in Rona, and then we'll come back to Russell.
It's very brief. And I thought, Convener, thanks for that. I thought I'd take the opportunity of the firework experts in front of me to ask this question, because I won't get a better opportunity. Can you able to explain to me in layman's terms what low noise is? What does it mean? What would it mean for me, or somebody with normal hearing? And also, I guess, if you're aware of the information, what might it mean for dogs? Because I know that they obviously have a different hearing system.
Okay. There's effectively three types of fireworks, right? And I'll try and keep this short. There's three types of fireworks. There's a type of firework that launches a projectile into the air, and that produces an effect with a very little noise. Now, the noise it generates when it shoots a projectile into the air, that's the same for whether the firework produces noise or not. But that tends to be a more localised noise rather than a distance travelling noise, OK? The common firework that we see in the UK is a firework that will launch a projectile, and it produces a bang, and the bang is produced to disperse the effect. And that makes the effect travel in the sky. The bang is actually secondary. The primary goal of the bang is to spread that burning effect in the sky. And that's what you see at the likes of Edinburgh Castle, where you get the big globe, etc. You'll hear the bang, but the bang is primarily there to generate the effect. The third type of firework is a firework which is pretty much prohibited, is a firework that its only intention is to make a bang. That is all its purpose is. They're very common in Europe, massively common in Poland, and that's called a salute effect, and that's the technical term for it. And certainly the industry, we view them as pretty anti-social fireworks, because there is no benefit to that firework other than the bang. That is its, and that's what a banger is. You know, Andy spoke about bangers. The only purpose of a banger is to produce a bang, nothing else, no colour, no effect.
So the first of those three are low noise.
Yeah.
And for humans and animals, as far as...
Low noise localised, and to give you a comparison, it's probably the equivalent of a petrol lawnmower. The noise that something like that would produce, it's probably the equivalent of a petrol lawnmower. In quite a localised area. Yeah, in quite a localised...
That's helpful. Thanks, Convener.
Rona, I'll bring you in, and then I'll bring in Russell.
Thanks, Convener. I was just asked, Norman, you're open all year round. I wonder if you could give the committee a picture of when your sort of peak sales are in that year. I'm assuming it might be November around fireworks night, but maybe if you could say if you have peaks in your year. The reason I'm asking is, you know, in my neighbourhood we have a pop-up fireworks shop, and they do their sales, you know, just over a short period, and I'm just wondering if that's something that you've thought about, and if you could give us an idea of what your pattern is over the year for sales.
Yes, of course, Bonfire Night and Hogmanay are the busiest periods in our shop, just like any other fireworks shop. But we are quite busy during the year. There isn't a lot of outlets all year round, so they can't go to a supermarket and buy one, but they can come to us. So we're in Aberdeen, so we're the only outlet in Aberdeen that sells them all year round. So we do sell a few. It's mostly for birthday parties, summer birthdays. Celebration of life seems to be a new thing, with pink and blue fireworks is quite popular. And another thing is quite popular is a celebration of life, when someone people celebrate their life by having fireworks and having more of a party. And that seems to be a popular thing that's been taken off over the last few years. So fireworks are popular all year round. If we restrict them, then all these things will be taken away. A gentleman, his grandfather was an Aberdeen supporter, so he came in and bought red and white fireworks to celebrate his life. If we evict these things will be taken away from the people in Scotland. They won't be able to celebrate like this, which will be a shame. But answering your question, yeah, definitely no November and holiday periods, without a doubt.
Okay. Thanks, Norman. Thank you. Thanks very much. Russell, do you want to come in?
Yeah, a couple of quick points that I don't think we've really covered. Jamie Green did mention the compensation that's proposed. Can you explain whether that's been explained to you properly and whether it would make any fundamental difference to the potential loss of trade?
We've had no information at all on any proposed compensation, how it would take place, how it would be judged and assessed. Nothing.
Right, OK. The other thing, it's a bit of a pet subject of mine, in the way Colette often asks about the low volume ones, is that no firework zones were what was initially proposed, and that's evolved into firework control areas, which might be harder for people to quite understand the nuances of. Would the industry support no firework zones, given the biggest issue seems to be around noise complaints?
It's a really difficult question, because a lot of the information that's been given out about no firework zones or firework free zones, we would kind of question the logic behind them. And if I can explain, it was stated in evidence that firework free zones had proved really successful in Berlin. And that was something that was mentioned, really successful in Berlin. But what wasn't explained is it's not a criminal offence to set a firework off in the street or a public space in Germany. What was introduced in Berlin was preventing fireworks being discharged in a public space, which is what the law has been here in the UK since 1875, for the entire UK. So you're being presented with arguments that say, well, this worked in Berlin. Well, what happened in Berlin is what happens in the whole of the UK currently. So it's comparing apples with oranges. And the other primary concern we have about the firework control zones or firework free zones, what it effectively does is take the existing legislation which prevents the use of fireworks in a public space or to cause fireworks to be launched into a public space, and bans consumers from using fireworks in their own property. And that's what this piece of legislation does. So it gives local authorities the power to prevent individuals from using fireworks in their own home, because it is already an offence to use fireworks in a public space.
And then it creates the
displacement, the whole situation. Yeah. Absolutely. But again, we've tried to engage and say, well, you know, we've had examples cited about what happened in Pollock Shields. And what happened in Pollock Shields was the discharge of fireworks in a public space. So there's no need for a firework control zone in Pollock Shields, because what is happening is already illegal. So how can you make something that's illegal more illegal? That's what confuses us.
Russell, just to answer your question, no firework zone or firework control zone. We would be concerned about describing it as a no firework zone, because, of course, it is possible to have an organised firework display in a no firework in a firework control zone as proposed. And that really is the alternative that is being given to the public, is if you can't have fireworks in a firework control zone, you can go to an organised display. But as a general observation, I rather fear that firework control zones just kick the problem further down the road. I think antisocial behaviour of the kind that we're trying to prevent is going to happen, whether it's fireworks or whatever it is, drinking or whatever, and we're just moving it.
And I suppose that's before you even get to who decides where the zones are. Yep. Do you apply for them? Do you need consensus locally? Is it a local authority decision?
Scottish superintendents said it was a minefield that didn't have to be created. And I've got to say we 100% agree with them. What is the objective of doing that? It's just going to displace and create more issues than it solves.
Okay, thank you.
Jamie, I think you want to come in.
Yeah, thanks. Look, there'll be people watching this session, especially those who've given evidence to us already, who'll be saying, well, I hear what you're saying. You've made some really sensible points, and you've made them well. But, you know, you're the industry body. Of course you don't want any further restriction. Of course you don't want us to go down this road. And I would just ask you to say, what would you say to those people? What is it that about your professional judgment that you're passing today that's not protectionist of your industry and more about what it is this bill specifically is trying to do and the way it's going about it? Because I think we're going to have to address that. Of course, you know, the feedback will be, of course you heard from the fireworks industry, of course they're against all this. Yeah. As it was with the working group, as you dissented from the report.
I was going to mention the working group. Throughout my entire involvement with the working group, I never once spoke about the commercial aspects. Not once. And for us, this is not a commercial, this is a public safety issue. And we can see nothing in the bill that will improve public safety. It just presents risk after risk after risk after risk consistently and doesn't address the core issue of the misuse of fireworks. Mm. I mean, and that's what we've said all the way through to the ministers, what we've said all the way through the working group. But as I said earlier, I was one voice in a room full of noise. And it's not about the commercials, it's not about the money, it is about public safety for us. And educate the public, safe, responsible, considerate use of fireworks. And if I can just briefly just add something, sorry. There's been mention of firework injuries, especially in kids. The number one cause of firework injury in children is sparklers. Sparklers. And we've seen from well-meaning organisations producing safety leaflets about using fireworks, etc. We've seen pictures on those leaflets of kids holding sparklers without gloves. Mm-hmm. Wearing gloves when you hold a sparkler is the number one rule on the instructions, yet organisations are producing literature that shows kids holding sparklers without wearing gloves. This comes back to this whole thing again. Coordinated approach on the safe, responsible, considerate use of fireworks.
And be careful what you wish for. We'll be banning sparklers next as well. So.
It's one, but then, in a serious point, if that was something that would work in a step change and we could see very little in the way of unintended consequences, then that is something we would sit and speak to the government about. Because if people come back and say, this is what's happening with kids. Okay, how can we address it? Is there a way in which we can get adults better educated on how kids should be using sparklers? Or is it time to look at the viability of that product? But that's something that will only happen with engagement with government rather than being locked outside the room.
And I guess, with permission, Commissioner, I do feel, though, there is an inevitability about this legislation. And I know we're only at stage one, we haven't even started talking about a report or any sort of consensus, but I just get the impression from the wider narrative around it that there's something going to be passed. What that final product looks like, I don't know. Yeah. But what I would ask you is, perhaps not now, but as we go through that process, is to work with the committee, using your professional judgment and experience, on the direction of travel of the bill, and where you think, if there is an inevitability that something will pass, what will we end up with that is at least manageable? You might not be happy with it. Mm-hmm. You might think it have unintended consequences for all the reasons you've given today. Mm-hmm. But if something's going to pass it, let's at least try and pass something that's workable. None of us want to pass bad law. So I would make that open offer to you.
The offer's there. We've repeatedly said that we want to engage with the government on that.
And if I can just very briefly say... To your point, we would say that. I'll take you back to my opening comments. I represent the professional display industry, and we are, in, through the regulations very much support going to an organised fireworks display. We have no interest in retail, but we don't want Scotland to make a big mistake. And we travel the world. I was, as you know, in Spain last week, but we travel the world and we see the situation in other countries. And we really fear the direction of travel. This is all being done with good intention, but it's in part being done with our eyes closed. I really welcome the idea of working with the committee and taking this further and developing something that is workable and that will serve Scotland. I really do, wholeheartedly, but please don't allow a black market to be created in Scotland, because you will not be able to get back from that.
Thanks, Camilla. Appreciate that. Thank you.
I think we might just have a final... Oh. Donna, in you come.
Thank you, just briefly. Just from what you said, I mean, that's great, and we would welcome you working. The problem is you haven't come up with anything today by way of any changes. So that makes me think, well, how could you work with us when you don't want any change, basically?
OK, it's perhaps a question for Fraser to answer, but I can only go on the fact that the British industry has worked with regulators for decades. And absolutely, this working group, I felt, was taking one direction of travel, and I was an observer for a lot of it, in that there are a large number of people in the room who all wanted to achieve one particular thing, and it doesn't matter how much Fraser says, whatever he says. I think we need a reset, and we need to sit down with industry. We've proposed this to the minister 2 weeks ago. We need to sit down with the industry and say, what can you suggest and what can you offer us? And I have absolutely no doubt that the industry, and that is Fraser and his colleagues, will have options and proposals that they can put forward.
Can I just come back to that? We wrote to the minister in 2020 with a 10-point proposal. We also sent that proposal to Westminster at the same time. Point one, there should be an annual national safety awareness campaign agreed and funded jointly between industry and government. Point two, enforcement agencies should receive additional seasonal funding to help tackle the growth in illegal fireworks. Point three, enforcement agencies to receive better training in detection and apprehension of illegal fireworks. And I personally gave a training session with COSLA to help trade and standards officers identify issues or illegal product. Point four, the minimum age for buying fireworks should be raised to 21. No one round the table has mentioned that. No one's thought about that. We proposed that the minimum age should be raised to 21. Why? To create a bigger disconnect from the teenagers and those that can legally buy fireworks. There's a lot of 17-year-olds, no 18-year-olds. There's not that many 17-year-olds, no 21-year-olds. Illegal fireworks sold via social media should have their sites taken down immediately, and OPSS are working on that, liaising with the likes of Amazon and Facebook and eBay. Fines for selling, possessing or using illegal fireworks should be increased, allowing the robust minimum sentencing. Again, the level 5 fines, I understand, in England have been raised from £5,000 to unlimited fines. Point 7, there should be a central contact point for reporting all firework-related misuse issues. Point 8, there should be a standardised reporting structure for injuries caused solely by fireworks to include the cause. Point 9, better resource for border control to prevent illegal fireworks entering the country. And this is a point to try and mitigate the risk from black market. Point 10, tougher sentencing for letting off fireworks in public places such as streets and shopping arcades. Tougher sentencing for using fireworks as weapons, especially against police officers and other emergency services. And we wrote to the minister in 2020 with that 10-point plan to say how things could be improved, and the industry would 100% support it and back it.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks very much. I'll bring in Russell Finlay for a final question, and then we'll just finally bring in Norman, just in case there's anything that he would like to...
A final question as well.
OK, thank you very much. I mean, the banning the sale to those under the age of 21 seems pretty sensible, not least because the criminal justice system now deems those aged under 25 to be not as the same level of maturity as those aged over 25. Going back to the issue of pyrotechnics, I don't know if the general public really understand the difference between fireworks and pyrotechnics. And the question is, has the increased misuse of pyrotechnics by some football fans perhaps been used not as an excuse but as a reason for this sense that something must be done about fireworks? That culture of some football fans using them, which didn't really exist before in the UK, more of a European thing, and is that therefore penalising legitimate and responsible firework users and indeed the industry?
It's a good question, and it's a very valid question. The situation, what happened in Pollock Shields, people saw that, this is ridiculous, something has to be done. The general public generally is not aware that what was happening there was illegal. The situation with flares and smokes being used in stadiums or along the side of the River Clyde, etc., or outside football stadiums. Again, the general public's perception is something needs to be done about that. They don't appreciate that much of that activity is already illegal. But if there are aspects, and again, this comes back to the thing, if the police came and sat and had an open and frank discussion and said, well, we don't feel we can deal with it because of this, then we could advise them and say, well, here's how we could close that bit off, tighten it more in respect to legislation, but not have subsequent impacts. And the reason I mention that, there is about 12 different pieces of legislation and regulation that cover fireworks and pyrotechnics. 12. Some of those pieces of legislation are defined by the United Nations. So if you start to get involved in deciding what's a pyrotechnic, what's a firework, trying to unpick things, it could literally be pulling a thread in a jumper, and before you know it, the sleeve of the jumper's fallen off because you've had knock-on effects associated with those other pieces of legislation. And that's what we're calling for. What we're calling for is have a discussion.
Yeah, thank you.
Much. I've got Pauline and then Katie, you want to come in, and then we'll bring the session to an end.
Thank you very much. Norman had said earlier that there's, you know, scope for more use of fireworks for celebrating. I mean, I would have to express a concern at the notion, therefore, that the industry position would be, therefore, that we would just have fireworks all year round. And if there's an increase in use of them, we wouldn't do anything. Because even with well-intentioned firework displays in your back garden, as you said earlier, they're going to annoy your neighbour and if your neighbour's got animals. So surely there's got to be... I don't have the answer to this, but surely use some food for thought for you. That are we really saying that if people want to celebrate the birth of their baby or whatever by using fireworks... Does that not imply there will be a further increase in use, and albeit legitimate and legal, and, well, you know, who wouldn't want to be there? Do you not see that having all year round is a problem for society?
I don't see it as being a problem for society if the public are being educated. So if the message was, if you're using fireworks out with the seasonal periods, there is these range of products available to you, there's the considerate use, there's the notification to your neighbour, etc., etc. In doing that sort of messaging from a non-legislative point of view and trying that in the first aspect of it, it minimises the risk of the unintended consequences. It minimises the risk of creating these opportunities for people to say, well, this is great, I'm going to stockpile a load of fireworks and I'll go on social media and tell people I've got them here, just come round to my house and I'll sort you out, because you cannot go and buy them legitimately. So we would much rather see a process by which...
No, I'm talking about setting them off.
Yes, and it's the same thing.
You take my point.
Yes, it's the same thing. If you could encourage consumers...
Are you saying... I just want to be clear... Yeah. I don't want you to talk around my point, if you don't mind.
Yeah.
I want to be clear. Are you OK with the notion that whatever we do here, that there'll be potentially more use of fireworks, if Norman's correct? And then that's OK, that we have a framework that says you can, okay, within certain times, have fireworks all year round, and we just rely on people to be kind to their neighbours, you wouldn't see that we might be back where we started if that was, there wasn't a way in which to curb that.
From a personal point of view, I would like to see a way in which we could encourage consumers to use lower noise fireworks out with those periods.
Thank you.
That's what I would like to see from a personal point of view.
Katie.
Thank you. There's a lot of issues that have been raised in the evidence which would require the committee to have a lot more data, but most of that data is probably not data that you would be best placed to provide. However, the first point of your action point is that there should be an annual national safety awareness campaign jointly funded by industry and government. Can I ask how much the industry currently spends on education and awareness?
The industry just last year decided we would actually produce our own videos, and we did. We spent, I think, on two videos or three videos, we spent about £20,000, and then we offered those videos for distribution through government. OPSS certainly redistributed them and publicised them through their social media feed. And this was targeted at the safe, responsible and considerate use of fireworks, kind of towards primary school kids. And it was more from a point of a peer sort of thing to be able to say to their parents or adults, no, you shouldn't be setting off loud noise fireworks at midnight and that sort of thing. And that was out of our own pocket. You know.
I think I've actually heard about these videos, but that's quite a small amount of money to spend. I presume you're a multi-million pound industry that makes massive profits. Can you tell us how much over the last 20 years you have devoted in terms of resources into education and raising awareness that might help deal with some of the challenges that this committee is attempting to grapple with? That might be something you could provide in writing.
Yes.
After this meeting, perhaps.
I can't give you that information just now, but yes. But as I said in the 10-point plan, the offer's there and we're working with OPSS on that at the moment.
OK, thank you very much indeed. I'm going to bring the session to a close. That's over 2 hours, so I think we've heard a lot of very helpful commentary from you. So thank you very much for attending. Obviously, if there are other things that you want to follow up and share with the committee, please feel free to do that and we'll take that evidence into account. So thank you very much for your attendance. And that concludes the public part of the meeting and we'll now move into private session to review the evidence that we've heard this morning. Thank you very much.